today that we remember the men, can you hear me, Pam?
Yep.
Okay. The men and women who have served in the armed forces, especially those who died in battle, to protect our nation and assist our allies around the world. We should honor those who have sacrificed several years out of their life in the defense of our country.
Yes.
And we should always remember those who lost their lives doing so. In the past decade or so, there's been a renewed sense of appreciation for the military, and I'm glad that's happening. In the 60s, perhaps some of you remember, during the Vietnam War, there was much anti-war propaganda being spread, and it became common for those who sat comfortably at home and had never experienced war to second-guess the soldiers out on the field and in the jungles. Incidents like the My Lai massacre only made the situation worse. It was a terrible, terrible time. A lot of lies being spread around. At that time, soldiers were treated with scorn and revilement. Young men chose to desert our country or go to prison rather than serve in the military. Many of the problems that our nation suffers from today stems from the anger, anarchy, and mistakes of that era. In some parts of society, contempt for the military continues. Our own son, Rick and I, our son who served in the Marine Corps and never left the United States, decided to take advantage of the GI Bill and enrolled in U of M. At the university, he was asked more than once, how many babies had he killed? Now my son is ashamed of his enlistment, even though he served with honor. Nowadays, if someone shows disrespect to a soldier, there's not much they can do except grin and bear it. But in the scripture, we read of an incident where some soldiers were treated shamefully by someone they had protected, and there was a far different outcome for it. Before David became king, he was living as a fugitive because King Saul was trying to kill him. He hid out in the wilderness and attracted a large band of men, all who were in distress or in debt or discontented gathered around him. Eventually, David had an army of 600 mercenaries. In between fighting the Philistines, they acted as security guards for farm workers. One day, David sent some of his men to Nabal's farm to ask for some food. It was sheep shearing time, and David knew that they would make a festival out of it because Nabal was very wealthy. He had 1,000 goats and 3,000 sheep. How would you like to shear all of that? But Nabal was an unpleasant and surly man. So David's men came to the farm. They gave Nabal David's respectful greetings, and they informed Nabal that they had protected his shepherds while they were in the fields so that no harm or loss came to them. So now would he please repay them with some food? Nabal's answer was, essentially, I don't know who this David is. Maybe he's just a runaway slave, so I'm not going to waste my food on him. Well, when David heard that, he was furious. So he told his men, everyone strap on their sword. And they took off for Nabal's farm, intending to kill every male, young or old, that they found. Meanwhile, a servant who witnessed what Nabal had said to the soldiers ran to tell Nabal's wife. Her name was Abigail. Abigail was a really cool person. She was as wise and perceptive as Nabal was foolish. So let's turn to 1 Samuel chapter 25 and see what happens.
Chapter 25,
starting at verse 14.
Thank you.
Otherwise, as surely as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, who has kept me from harming you. If you had not come quickly to meet me, not one male belonging to Nabal would have been left alive by daybreak." Then David accepted from her hand what she had brought him and said, "Go home in peace. I have heard your words and granted your request." The moral of that story is, it's never wise to anger a man who has a weapon in his hand and makes his living by killing people. If you read the rest of the story, you'll find out that the next day, Abigail told her husband what happened, and he suffered a heart attack from the shock of it. And about 10 days later, he died, and Abigail married David. The Lord had taken vengeance for David. Of course, the greatest battle in human history was waged by a lamb. A significant amount of blood was shed. There was certainly death, but what looked like a hopeless losing battle won the salvation of all who would believe in the Lamb of God. Wars are usually fought for fame and glory, but Christ was already acknowledged and glorified by angels and the elements of nature. Wars are also fought to acquire land, but Christ had no need for land because he created everything that has been created, not just on earth, but clear to the farthest galaxy. He is the author of it all. And then men fight wars to control other men. But Christ endured Calvary to set men free from the control of sin and death. On the cross, Jesus suffered the full wrath of God poured out on him for our sake. The weapons of Christ's warfare were complete humility, submission to the will of God, and obedience to the Father. The Son of God, who could call 10,000 angels into action on his behalf, allowed himself to be tortured, insulted, and abused by his own creation. Those Roman soldiers and Jewish politicians and religious authorities were loved by Jesus, but they were dull of understanding. Galatians chapter 1, verse 4. Says that he gave himself for our sins to rescue us from the present evil age, according to the will of our God and Father. Romans chapter 6, verse 6, we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be rendered powerless, that we should no longer be slaves to sin. Romans 8:37, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. And how much did he love us? Romans 5:8. But God proves his love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Therefore, since we have been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from wrath through him? We will probably never fully understand what Jesus endured at the cross. It's not the same thing as a soldier going into battle, but Christ laid down his life for the benefit of others. He sacrificed himself even though he didn't have to. He did it because he loves us. He did it because we could not do it for ourselves. He did it and won the victory over the enemy. With Paul, we proclaim, "I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew and then to the Greek. And thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." 40 days after the crucifixion, Jesus ascended to heaven in the clouds. And at that time, he gave a commission to his followers: go into all the world and make disciples, baptizing them and teaching them to obey my words. Jesus won the battle at Calvary, but there is still much work to be done to prepare for the most monumental war of all time, Armageddon. As followers of Christ, we are now soldiers in the army of God. The weapons of our warfare are also unlike that of today's soldier. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5, "For though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ." When we take captive every thought, sometimes the enemy is in our own mind. That's where the battle often is. To win the lost, we don't shoot them or beat them with a hammer. We love them. We share the gospel with them. We pray for them. We preach and teach God's truth. Unbelievers are not our enemy. The devil is. And every time we act like Christ instead of like the world, we strike another death blow upon the enemy. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 8. Here are our weapons. "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the full armor of God so that you will be able to stand firm against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the full armor of God so that you will be able to resist in the evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm."
Amen.
"Stand firm, therefore, having girded your loins with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. In addition to all, taking up the shield of faith, with which you will be able to extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. With all prayer and petition, pray at all times in the Spirit, and with this in view, be on the alert with all perseverance and petition for all the saints." One day, Christ will ride out of heaven on a white horse, and all the armies of heaven, that's us, will be following him.
Amen.
The armies of hell will be arrayed on the battlefield, but they will be slain with the sharp sword that proceeds out of his mouth. That's the word of God, which is living and active. Hebrews chapter 4 says it's sharper than any earthly double-edged sword. It pierces even to dividing the soul from the spirit, joints and marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. The heart. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and exposed before the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. Men and women will continue to be sent into war for worldly gains. They will continue to be maimed, scarred, and tormented by the memories of their wartime experiences. They will continue to die because sinful men cannot live in peace, and wars will continue to be lost. But when the King of Kings and Lord of Lords leads his army into the final battle, we know that we have certain victory, and the end is already written in his word. The war is already won, and in that day there will be no more need for soldiering. Let's pray.